In God I will praise his word. In God I have put my trust. I will not fear what flesh can do unto me. God is our refuge and strength, a very present help in trouble. Therefore, will not we fear, though the earth be removed, and though the mountains be carried into the midst of the sea, though the waters thereof roar and be troubled, though the mountains shake with the swelling thereof. There is a river, the streams thereof shall make glad the city of God, the holy place of the tabernacles of the Most High. God is in the midst of her, she shall not be moved. God shall help her, and that right early. The heathen raged, the kingdoms were moved. He uttered his voice, the earth melted. The Lord of hosts is with us. The God of Jacob is our refuge. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me, bless his holy name. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and forget not all his benefits. Jesus said, I am the resurrection and the life. He that believeth in me, though he were dead, yet shall he live. And whosoever liveth and believeth in me shall never die. Believest thou this? You may be seated. I want to welcome everyone today to this celebratory service for the life of Vida Veronica Waul. And on behalf of my own family, my church, I want to express sincere condolences to the bereaved family and trust, and I know that God will give you strength and grace to go through this very difficult period in your life. The passing of your very precious mother, grandma, auntie, and so on. And at this point, I want to let you know that the interment is going to be indoors, so you don't have to worry about the cold too much. It's a challenging weather that we're having right now, but we can make it through. Amen? I want you to join me at this time in singing the hymn, How Great.
I'm Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, power, and glory, forever. Amen.
The first lesson, which will be read by Ruth Thomas, it comes from 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 50 to 58, and I'm going to ask that we follow the program accordingly. I will now be coming up to announce what is going to be happening. So please follow the program if you are on there for me. Let's see, Ruth.
Reading from 1 Corinthians, let me read in verse 50 to 58. Now I say this, brethren, that flesh and blood cannot inherit the kingdom of God, nor does the perishable inherit the imperishable. Behold, I tell you a mystery. We will not sleep, but we will all be changed. In a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trumpet, for the trumpet will sound, and the dead will be raised imperishable, and we will be changed. For this perishable must put on the imperishable, and this mortal shall put on immortality. But when this perishable will have put on the imperishable, and this mortal will have put on immortality, then will come about the saying that is written, death is swallowed up in victory. O death, where is your victory? O death, where is your sting? The sting of death is sin, and the power of sin is the law. But thanks be to God, who gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. Therefore, my beloved brethren, be steadfast, immovable, always abounding in the works of the Lord, knowing that your toil is not in vain in the Lord. This is the reading. Have a blessed morning.
Good morning. Purdy has been in my life for as long as I can remember. With all the tears, laughter, and good and bad times, she's always been there for me. She was there when I took my first steps and said my first words. She was there for everything. Purdy was such a beautiful person inside and out. She always had a smile on her face. Such a beautiful smile. Whenever she smiled, everyone around her smiled. Her smile lit up the room. Pearlie was one of the most kind and caring person I've ever come across. She always put others before herself. She was always taking care of everyone, always making sure that everyone was okay. When I heard she was gone, my whole world came crashing down. I still can't believe my precious Pearlie is gone. It feels like a big part of me is missing. The last time I saw Pearlie was around this time last year. My mom always told me, go visit Pearlie, go visit her. I regret not going to see her, and there's no excuse as to why I didn't go. I guess procrastination is my reason. I've learned that you can't take the people that you love for granted. I love you, Pearlie, and you'll always have a special place in my heart.
the gift of love. Now you're sharing it up above. You had many things to say, all in a caring way. You always saw good in everyone, no matter what they've done. You were always the one we could all lean on, even though it must have felt like a ton. You were always the strength of the family. Now we must let you rest calmly. As we say goodbye, as tears roll down our eyes, I know your place in heaven has a good view, because you tell me, God, I need to keep an eye. I know you will always be in our hearts and minds. So, Grandma, I must go, but I'll never forget your one of a kind.
I never thought I'd be up here today saying goodbye to such a wonderful person. I met Curly 17 years ago, and I can say from then till now, she's been a blessing in my life, and I truly loved her. She was kind, gentle, caring, but she's also very strong at the same time. She loved her family and always wanted everyone around her to be okay. I felt like there was always a place for me back home. I was always welcome there. Many times I would go over to the house and just sit with Pearlie in the middle of the day and watch TV. We'd watch soap operas. And of course she'd feed me, because everybody in this church knows that Pearlie just feeds everybody. If you went over there on a Sunday, you would just have an array of food to choose from. She's famous for her oxtail. It'd be chicken, fish, whatever you can think of would be there. She loved to cook and she was amazing at it. And you could tell she cooked from her heart because she just wanted to take care of everybody around her. She was driven by the love that she had for those who were dear to her. Another thing that me and Pearlie have in common is her love of fashion. She loved to go shopping and loved to dress up. Whenever there was an event, Pearlie would go all out. You'd see her walking around in her little high heels, and I'm like, Pearlie, how can you imagine those shoes? But she did. I remember going over to the house one day, and I bought a new jacket, and she was like, "Like a jacket, which way I buy it?" So I told her, and you know, I thought that was the end of it. And then when I was leaving, I went to the door, and she came up, and she whispered to me, "When you go back at mom, I wanted a jacket for me, and I'll pay you back." And she just followed me and whispered, because she didn't want her kids to hear it, because they would say, "Pearlie, you have so much already, you don't need anything." Being up here is really hard, because you never expect these days saying goodbye to people we love, but the Lord knows best. Pearlie, your body may not be here anymore, but you live on in our hearts forever. We spend a lot of time in life trying to gain material things, but what we should be really trying to gain is the love and respect of people around us, because in the end, that's what matters, because you can't take things with you. But from everybody in here today, we can see that Pearlie was loved and she was a rich woman. And I've seen the last 2.5 weeks how many people cared and loved Pearlie. And I just want to say, Pearlie, I love you. You will forever be in my heart, and rest in peace.
So just adding a little bit to what my sister said, she pretty much summed it up very well. But in 1997, when we first went over to the new revolved household, we were just kids, but we became like honorary members of the 425 crew, the number of the house. And that's what we always talk about and laugh about. We always felt like we're part of the family. Pearlie was like the head of everything, and we always just felt like she was a grandmother to us, and she pretty much became a grandmother. She had a very calm spirit, and she never wanted to kill anybody's vibe. She was always just like, "Do what you guys want, right?" The memories that will stick to us the most are the Thanksgivings and the Christmases, and even the Easter that we would go over to the household, and Pearlie would do the cooking, and everybody would just have the best time laughing. All the people that came through that house must have felt like they were part of the family, because we were fed. We were always laughing. Even my brother, little brother Jackson, used to say that he loves to go over to Pearlie's house because she cooks the best food. And that's what I want to sum up with. And I remember this summer I went over and visited Pearlie. I just knocked on the door, and she would just answer the door and just peek out and see who it is, because I don't think she could even see the people. Nonetheless, and she was always welcoming whenever we were there. And I remember I said that when I went there, she was with all her grandkids. Oh my gosh, she loved those grandkids so much. So I sat with her and I talked with her, and you could tell she was happy that, because I hardly come over, but she was very happy that. And I remember leaving and I gave her a hug and said, "I love you, Pearlie," and it was a great memory to have. And it was just, it's really weird, because just a few months later, she got this diagnosis. And I remember visiting her in the hospital a couple of times, and She was very happy to see me, and I was very happy to see her. Those are the moments I'll, you know, cherish, when she's always laughing and smiling. Again, Pearlie wouldn't want us to be up here all sad, even mourning for her. She always, you know, always said, we all right. So I just want to leave with that. Pearlie, we'll always miss you, and you'll always be in our hearts forever. Thank you.
Where do I even begin? I never ever thought I would be up here, because I thought I would have my grandma forever. Well, that's what we all wanted when it comes to our loved ones. My grandma was my everything. She was a mother, a friend, and a confidant. She was the rock of the family. I could go to my grandma for anything. She was that great. She gave me nothing but unconditional love. From a baby to an adult, my grandmother cared and loved for me the same. If you were a friend of mine, you were a friend of my grandma, Pearlie. I'm very happy knowing she shared many milestones of my life, especially the birth of my daughter. Losing her has been very painful, but I'm happy knowing I have no regrets when it comes to my grandma. She knew how much I loved her and did anything for her. No matter how tired I would be, if she needed something, or for me to take her to do her errands, I'd always be ready and willing. I could stand up here for hours stating how amazing my grandma was, but the love around can show you all. There's a quote that states, "Grandma, one single word that holds a thousand happy memories," and that's what I'll live on and cherish forever with both my daughter, Nevaeh, and myself. Rest in peace, Grandma Pearlie.
Ecclesiastes chapter 3, verses 1 to 11, and Miss Cynthia Holmes.
Praise the Lord. Says Ecclesiastes 3, 1 to 11. To everything, there's a season, and a time to every purpose under the heaven. A time to be born, a time to die. A time to plant, and a time to pluck up that which is planted. A time to kill, and a time to heal. A time to break down, and a time to build up. A time to weep, and a time to laugh. A time to mourn, and a time to dance. A time to cast away stones, and a time to gather stones together. A time to embrace and a time to refrain from embracing. A time to get and a time to lose. A time to keep and a time to cast away. A time to rend and a time to sow. A time to keep silence and a time to speak. A time to love and a time to hate. A time of war and a time of peace. What profit has he that worketh in that wherein he laboreth? I have seen the travail which God has given to the sons of men to be exercised in it. He hath made everything beautiful in his time. Also, he hath set the world in their heart, so that no man can find out the word that God made it from the beginning.
Good morning, everyone. Vida Veronica Waul, Pearlie, Grandma Pearlie, was born February 7, 1942 in Kingston, Jamaica. After the passing of her beloved husband, Norman, she immigrated to Canada in 1994. She was a dedicated mother and grandmother to her children and the numerous children she takes care of in her home. The children affectionately called her Grandma Pearlie. Her passion was cooking and dedicated her time to looking after children. It was a close-knit family affair. Everyone who visited the famous 425 Oil Springs knows once you get there, it is hard to leave. because Grandma Pearlie always had lots of food to offer. It got to the point where the children did not want to eat at home, and so the food did not taste like Grandma Pearlie's cooking. You could have Shada or Mason showing up in the morning with their cornmeal for Grandma to make cornmeal porridge for them. Or Araya complained about not having the good hot chocolate if somebody else made it. There was Colin, who refused to have any other juice except for Grandma Pearlie's spicy juice. His dad was curious to know what this spicy juice was. And this was her famous homemade pineapple drink with ginger. Even the parents were in on Grandma's meal. When they pick up the kids, they always leave with their takeout boxes. Grandma Pearlie likes to cook and entertain, but like to have her downtime watching a good suspense movie on her favorite spot on the couch. She was a happy lady and was always smiling. Not very vocal, but a good listener and a great confidant. She lives life to the fullest. She strongly believed in treating herself well, especially when you work really hard. She has expensive taste, so when you see her out there, she was always looking dapper, from the hair down to her shoes. She was 71 years old when she passed, but did not look a day older than 59 years old. Our beloved Pearlie was diagnosed with stomach cancer July 29, 2013. It was very brief. God knows that she was the rock of the family and her work was done. He did not want this precious rose to suffer. So he calmly took her home to rest, exactly 3 months to the date she was diagnosed. Mom, we will be fine. We'll keep that family bond even stronger than before and take care of each other. We'll make sure Nat is well fed. As a cooking torch is now handed over to Charlene. We love you, Mom. Rest in peace.
It's good to be that strong, to be able to stand and wear a smile, such a big smile on your face at this time. You are perhaps now the rock in the family. May God bless you. You're going to be blessed by this selection for Yvonne.
Praise God. You know, I've known Pearl since the late 60s, and I didn't know her name was Vida. Praise God. You know, I was asked to do something in the memory of Pearlie, and there's only one song that came to mind. Because this song brings back memories of Pearlie, and Molly, and Cheryl, Aaron, Mr. Percy, and Mr. Frank, you know, and everybody. And I just decided to do this song. Amen. If you know, just sing along with me.
The chimes of time ring out the news. Another day is through. Someone slipped and fell. Was that someone you? You may have longed for at its strength, your courage to renew. Do not be disheartened, for I have news for you. It is no secret what God can do. What is done for others, He'll do for you. With arms wide open, He'll pardon you. It is no secret what God you. There is no night, for it is light, you'll never be alone. You'll always be alone, wherever you may roam. There is no power can conquer you, while God is on your side. Just take it at His promise, don't run away and hide. It is no secret what God can do. What He's done for others, He'll do the same for you.
Christians are concerned, even atheists are concerned about the future. So we have questions. You have questions. I have questions. And we look for answers for a lot of the questions that we have. But some of the questions that we haven't asked, we find no answer. This young man that is referred to as the rich young ruler, he had a weighty question on his mind, and it seemed urgent and needed an answer. So he came running to Jesus and he knelt before him and he asked this question. eternal life. He had a concern. He was conscious that there was such a thing as eternal life. And his question was about the future. Eternal life. The eternal state of man. What is that going to be? This was a hopeful meeting with Jesus. He probably had that question for a long time. And now he has his opportunity and he posed it. And it begs the question, is there such a thing as eternity? Is eternity for real? It is for real. Eternity is something that is real. Now the Bible tells us that the God of the Bible is eternal. Our Creator is eternal. He is not limited to time and space. The scripture calls him the first and the last, the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end, the everlasting God. And the Bible says from everlasting to everlasting, He is God. Eternity is for real. And the ushering in of eternity is a time of rewards. As far as man is concerned, when eternity begins, it's a time of rewards. It's a time of our accountability to the God who made us. And all men will be rewarded according to their works, whether good or evil. Our eternal destiny is settled right here on earth as we live. It is safe to say then that eternity begins right here. You see, when we come to the end of life, no change will happen. Our time on earth is a time of probation. It's a time allotted to us, a time given to us, and then one day, that time is going to come to an end. And after this, we appear before Almighty God. The young man had some knowledge of God. He understood that there was a God. He understood that life continues after this. Because what we have in front of us is the remains of our sister. Her soul, her spirit, the Bible says, goes back to God who gave it. So this is not the end. The Bible tells us that after death comes the judgment. So Jesus looked at the young man and he answered him, "Why do you call me good? There is none good except one, and that is God." How many of you know God is good? The Bible said in Psalm 25, "Good and upright is the Lord. Therefore will he teach sinners in the way." Psalm 33:5 says, "The earth is full of the goodness of the Lord." And then Romans 2:4 says, Paul wrote this. He said, "The goodness of God leads men to repentance." In other words, when we have come to understand the goodness of God, it causes us to repent. The young man was quick to say to Jesus, after Jesus said, "You know the commandments," because his question is, "What shall I do?" One writer wrote, "What good thing shall I do that I might inherit eternal life?" Jesus said, "You know the commandments," and he named some of them. And the young man said, he was quick to answer, "Wow, all of these I've known from my youth, and I have practiced them." And Jesus said to him, "But you lack one thing. and sell what you have and give to the poor. When we ask the Lord a question, we do not always get the answer we desire. But one thing is sure, we'll get the answer we need. He didn't like what he heard. He didn't like the answer Jesus gave him. But Jesus gave him the answer that he needed to hear. Do the commandments. I've done them all my life. And Jesus is saying to him, your works are not enough. The scripture says, by grace are we saved through faith, not of yourselves. It is the gift of God. It's not of works, lest any man should boast. We are saved only on the merit of the finished work of Jesus Christ at Calvary's cross. Nothing else can save us, and God requires nothing else of us, and nothing less, nothing more. And God is still saying to us, I still give eternal life. I still offer eternal life. It is freely given. The Bible said Jesus looked at him and loved him. Jesus loves you, and he loves me. He loves us today. He looked at him and loved him and said, you lack one thing. Go sell what you have and give to the poor, and you will have treasure in heaven. And then he said, and take up the cross and follow me. It's all good to give away all that we have, give to the poor, do all the good things, and have treasure in heaven. But the ultimate thing Jesus is saying, take up the cross. After you have done all of that, that's good. But take up the cross and follow me. We have got to take up the cross and follow me and follow Jesus. Jesus said, my yoke is easy and my burden is light. I don't give you burden to bear. I bear your burdens. Take up your cross and follow me. He said in Matthew 16:24, if any man shall come after me, let him deny himself and take up his cross and follow me. The Bible said the young man was sad at the saying of the Lord Jesus, sell what you have and give to the poor. We ought to care for the poor. He had sadness in his heart. He had sorrow in his heart, though he was told the right thing. He was not willing to give up his earthly possessions for earthly pleasures. It's good to give up earthly treasures for heavenly pleasures. He went away sad, the Bible said. Why? Because he had great possessions. When it comes down to this, for you and for me, what matters is what was done for Christ. Yes. Somebody said, we have one life, and it will soon be passed. Only what is done for Christ will last. Yes. That's the only thing that we take into eternity. Nothing else. And Jesus is still saying to us today, take up the cross and follow me. You will get eternal rewards in heaven. You will live and reign with Jesus Christ. Christ has great riches for us in eternity. The ills of this side, the ills of time, will be no more. There will be no more. There will be no more sorrow. There will be no more heartache, no pain. No grief, for the Bible said, death will be vanquished. And God shall wipe away all tears from their eyes. Sorrow will be no more. There will be no more seed. There will be no more parting. And God will be our God, and we will be his children.
He will be a father to us, and we'll be his children. And so Jesus said to the young man, you need to do all of these things and take up the cross and follow me. You see, there are two places that we go after this. It's hard to say, but we go to heaven or we go to hell. There are two places. And I would say to you, choose ye this day whom ye will serve. For this God of the Bible loves you. And he loves me with all of his heart. He wants us saved. He wants us to come into his kingdom. This is what Jesus said. The thief comes to steal, kill, and to destroy. But I am come that you might have life and have it more abundantly. Now what thief is he talking about? He's talking about the devil. He comes to steal our children, our husbands, our wives. He comes to destroy them. He comes to put our children on drugs, in alcohol, and cause them to do all manner of evil. He has all that for them, and to destroy families and to destroy our lives. But Jesus said, I am come to reverse that. I am come that you will have life, and that you will have it in its abundance. That's why I came, to destroy the works of the devil. But it can only happen when we take up the cross and follow Jesus. He said, whosoever believes in me shall not perish, but shall have eternal life, everlasting life. That's eternity, life that is timeless. You see, eternity is timelessness. It's a place where time is not measured by days, months, weeks, nor years. It goes on forever in the presence of the living God for those who have taken up the cross and followed Jesus. But the choice is ours, and it's always ours. And I want us to know in a simple language that God does not send anybody to hell. He does not. It's not his will. His will is that you might be saved. His will is that you might love him. His plan originally was not that we become laborers and working hard and getting old and sick and dying. That happened because man sinned. And Jesus is saying, I will reverse that. He has already done that. But it's for us to accept it. We will go back to paradise. Just as God planned it. There will be no devil, there will be no temptation. We'll just be praising God forever in paradise. We shall live and reign with him forever. The Bible said, for God so loved the world that he gave us son, that whosoever believes in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. God sent not his son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world through him might be saved. And Jesus said, whosoever lives and believes in me shall never die. Believest thou this? If you believe this, you're on your way unto eternal life. Our eternal destiny is settled while we walk this earth. Our eternal life begins while we are on this earth. It doesn't start when we die and cross over to the other side. It starts right here on earth. The first step we take to Jesus to say, yes, Lord, I am a sinner. And I need you as my Savior. I don't want to enter eternity without you. That first step says, you're on your way to live and to reign with him forever. Jesus said to the young man, go sell what you have, give to the poor, and take up the cross and follow me. You will have life eternal. What a blessing to get from a loving God. Jim Elliot said these words, he is no fool who gives up what he cannot keep for what he cannot lose. You cannot lose with Jesus. You cannot lose eternal life with Jesus. But you can lose your earthly possessions. A typhoon can come, not here. A twister can come. All natural disasters can destroy man's life. But there is a life that never ends. And it is with Jesus Christ, our loving Lord and our loving Savior. And he's calling all men to come. He said, come unto me, all ye that labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Do you want rest from our Lord Jesus? Do you want eternal life? It begins right here with your first step in coming to him and say, Lord, save me. Would you bow your heads, please? Eternity is real. Hell is real. Heaven is real. And I know there are people here today who have not made that first step to say, yes, Lord, I want to serve you. I want to be with you in eternity. If there's somebody here today that wants me to pray for you right where you are, I'm not going to ask you to stand. Just raise your hand and put it down. You want to be saved. God bless you. Is there another person? God bless you. Is there another? God bless you. Is there another? You say, yes, I want to spend eternity with Jesus. God bless you. Is there another? Is there somebody else? You say, yes, I want eternity with Jesus. God bless you. God is a good God. I want you to consider that today you have given your life to Jesus. And I will say that you go your way and see no more. Boy, I'm going to pray for you. Father, thank you for today. And I thank you, Lord, for your words. Your words of hope. And your words that tell us of eternal life. We thank you for your power. We thank you for your might. We thank you for life and light. And we thank you for these souls, Lord, who have indicated their intention to serve you, to love you, to worship you. I pray that your Holy Spirit will enter their lives. You will guide them. You will protect them. You will bless them. I pray, mighty God, windows of heaven will be opened to them. And we will pour them out a blessing in the name of Jesus. Secure their souls, I pray, for eternity. Lord, have your way, we pray. I commend everyone to your care and to your keeping. I ask it in Jesus' holy name. We say, amen. God is good. Would you bow your heads and wave and pray for the family? Heavenly Father, we thank you that we can cast all of our cares upon you. We thank you that even in the presence of death, there is life. For Lord, you are the resurrection and the life. You understand human weakness. You understand our pains. You understand our sorrows and our griefs. You wept at the grave of Lazarus. And so we know, Lord, in your humanity, you can share our pain. You've been there. We know we have not a high priest who cannot be touched with the feelings of our infirmities, but we can touch you. We can touch you at your heart. And so I pray for the grieving family, Jackie and Sophia and the rest, in the name of Jesus, that your presence will be with them to give comfort and strength and grace, even at this time, that as they go through this valley, you will be with them. Mighty God, I pray that your Holy Spirit will minister and give comfort in the name of Jesus. And may they realize the hope that they have in Jesus Christ, the hope that is freely given for all humanity, that we can accept your grace, and one day we shall live and reign with you forever. I pray for everyone that is gathered here today. I pray that your peace that passes understanding will keep our hearts and our minds together, that the life, Lord, that we live will bring glory and honor unto your great and matchless name. Help us to realize that our days on earth are short days, that eternity is long and it is forever. So teach us to number our days, that we may apply our hearts unto wisdom. Have your way now, I pray. I ask it in the name of your son, Jesus. And we say, amen and amen. I want us to go a little bit faster.
Sweet.